Hello. Testing, testing. 1, 2. Okay, so good day, good night, good afternoon, all those who are watching us on the internet. Thank you for being with us again another week. And we've been doing Revelation 15 and 16. The Torah portion this week is Shaftim, and we'll be reading the psalm that is associated with that, Psalm 82. 1 to 8 will be read by Miss Phyllis.
God takes a stand in his own congregation. He judges in the midst of the rulers. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked? Salah. Vindicate the weak and fatherless. Do unjust to the afflicted and destitute. Rescue the weak and needy. Deliver them out of the hand of the wicked. They do not know, nor do they understand. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, you are gods, and all of you are sons of the Most High. Nevertheless, you will die like men and fall like any one of the princes. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for it is you who possesses all the nations.
I can say long, because I'm running too. Amen. Okay. All right, so with Psalm 82, the Lord says he will give justice and he gives us judgment and meet us judgment. Amen? Okay, so we're going to do Revelation 15. We have been doing the book of Revelation. Revelation 1 all the way to 14 now. Now we're going to Revelation 15 and 16. We're doubling up this morning because Revelation 15 and 16 is related. 15 is a foreshadowing of 16. So we're going to do Revelation chapter 15 and 16 talk about the plagues, and we said that nothing new is in the Revelation. Everything is from the Tanakh. Everything is from the Old Testament, and we're going to see similarities here between the plagues in the end of days and the plague that was given into Egypt. So the Lord is going to send plagues before he comes, the same way he sent the plagues in Egypt before he took them out. Okay? So we're going to look at this at the slides now and do our presentation, so those who are watching can follow us along. The seven angels prepare themselves in Revelation 15 and verse 1. And it says, I saw in heaven another great and marvelous sign, seven angels with the seven last plagues. Last, because with them God's wrath is completed. I remember we just read in Psalm about his judgment, right? And in the Torah portion of Shaftim, we read, justice, justice. And here is God is going to stand up to his own law and bring forth justice to people. They're going to have good justice and bad justice. Bad in a sense that it's not good for the people who are receiving the bad judgment. But it's good because it's God who's doing it. And everything he does is good, right? Of course, absolutely. So that's what it says in 15 and verse 1. So we move on now. See what we have. Okay, there are the seven angels with the seven bowls of wrath. Just to give you a picture of what John was saying, trying to get into his mind. And so we have the seven angels preparing to give out the plagues. And we're going to see how these plagues are similar to, and the handouts I gave you will show you all of that too. And those who are watching can look at the screen. You can pause it, take notes, and come back. That's the beauty of the technology now, okay, and YouTube. And we have it on our website, the Carl and Med We Are, the Scripture of Truth.net. You can find all the Revelation stuff that we have been doing so far, all the Revelation presentations. Okay, so we move on. Okay, so we move to verse 6, because it's just a similarity with other verses. It says, out of the temple came the seven angels with the seven plagues. They were dressed in clean, shining linen, and they wore golden sashes around their chest. Amen. Who else wore golden sashes? We know the priests wear golden sashes around there. So these people are assisting the Messiah in his temple, because they said they're out of the temple. They're coming out of the temple, not the temple on earth. Don't get it confused. It's the temple in heaven where God is and Yeshua is right now. That's where they are. Okay, so we see the golden sash around their chest. Okay, we move on. It says in chapter 16 now, which gives us the presentations of the plagues, says in verse 1, we can read together. It says, "Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, 'Go, pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth.'" Now this is after God's people are sealed. Remember in Revelation 7 and Revelation 14, God's people are sealed with his seal. And we said his seal is an embodiment of his commandments, including the fourth commandment, which says, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." And also the feast of Sabbaths, which includes Passover and all those things. The Feast of Trumpets coming up, Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, and Tabernacles, when Yeshua will tabernacle with us. And we're going to see Tabernacles in Revelation 21. Okay, so here we see, he says, "Go. Time for you to go, because I have made my judgment, and those who will receive it will receive." So we're going to see who will receive the plagues. Okay, so we move on. So in verse 2 it says, "The first angel went, and he poured out his bowl on the land, and an ugly and painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast, and they worship his image." So those people who are disobedient. Now, the mark of the beast, as we know, is for those people who are disobedient. And here we see an example of what the sore might look like. It's just an example. Sores breaking out all over. But this time it's going to be massive for all those who are disobedient. And in Revelation 14, we saw the Bible says, "Here is the patience of the saints." Revelation 14, 12. "Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Yeshua." In opposition to those who are received the mark of the beast. Mark of the beast, in general, are those who are disobedient to God's commands. So he said the first angel, the first sore, the first plague are those who receive boils. And did we have boils and sores in the Egyptian plagues? Yes, this is a picture of what will happen before Yeshua comes. Okay, so we move on. And it says the second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it turned into blood like that of a dead man, and every living thing in the sea died. Everything is going to be dead in the sea, so to speak. See, it turns into blood red, and we have the same similarities in Egypt. It's just the Lord is just touching everything that man uses for his benefit. You see, merchants, we're going to see that later. We're going to do a comparison. We're just running through these plagues now, the verses, and we're going to see a comparison of that with the Old Testament as we go along. So we're just going through these quickly. So we move on. And the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the rivers and the springs of waters, and they became blood. So everything is going to be touched. The sea, rivers, and living waters. I remember all these things, rivers and living and springs of water, is a representation of also of the gospel of Yeshua. Because he says, "Out of you shall flow rivers of living water if you accept him." Right? So his message also will be affected, literally and symbolically. Okay. See, it turns into blood also. Alright, so we move on to the fourth angel now. "And the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun. And the sun was given power to scorch people with fire." It's hot. "They were seared by the intense heat, and they cursed the name of God, who had control over these plagues, but they refused to repent and glorify him." See that? That people are like that. No matter how many punishment you get from God to turn around, they always curse him. Like the children of Israel in the wilderness. They were going through some problems, no food, it's hot. They curse God. "Why did you take us out of Egypt?" Your people are going to be like that forever, all through the ages. Alright? And they refuse to repent. So let us not refuse to repent. This is a warning for us that we must repent and give glory unto him. But the Bible said that they refuse to do so. Alright, so we move on. Because we're going to do a summary, so we're moving on to these things. The sun became hot. People today talking about, the preparation could be global warming, maybe preparing for that intense heat the Lord is going to use. Okay, so we move on. Fifth angel. Our fifth angel now, verse 10 says, "He poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast," "and his kingdom was plunged into darkness. Men gnawed their tongues in agony and cursed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, but they refused to repent again for what they had done. Same thing like Pharaoh. He refused to repent. The Bible said he hardened his heart. And so people today are going to be doing the same thing. In that time, they're going to be hardening their heart when they see all these things. Instead of acknowledging and bow the knee and say, God is God, say, hey, if I could catch him, I'd kill him. That's what they're going to say. Catch God, I'd kill him. All these things he's doing. That's what they're saying. Okay, so we move on. So he said the beast. Remember we talk about the beast. Seven heads and ten horns. That's a system, the Lord says. The system itself is going to be in darkness because they think they have light. The Lord is going to plunge them into darkness. Same thing happened in Egypt. There was darkness over the Egyptians. All right? So the Lord is going to take vengeance for his people. He's going to give us justice. Remember the Torah portion this week. Justice, justice. We need justice. The Lord is going to give his people justice. Okay, so we move on. And that's the beast kingdom with seven heads and ten horns. We saw about that previously. Next week, we're going to do Revelation 17. We're going to look closely more of this beast with a woman, I think, sitting on the beast. Okay, so we move on. Okay, so the sixth angel now did something here. We're going to look into this. This is what we may spend most of our time with. It says, and the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up to prepare the way for the kings from the east. And we're going to be talking about this. A lot of people are looking at this and say there are a lot of things that are going to happen in the Middle East. It says, so we're seeing a picture of the Euphrates River, and we're going to see the connection symbolically, because Revelation is a book of symbols, and he uses the Old Testament, the Tanakh terms, to give us an understanding. It's not that some people are looking for these things to happen literally, but there's more spiritual symbolism that is far greater than the literal application. Okay, so we move on. Okay. So before the pouring out of the seventh bowl, the Lord gave us something about Armageddon. So we're going to talk about what that is. Many people are interested in that and give all different kind of speculations. So we're going to let the Bible speak today about what that is. So it says, then I saw three unseen spirits look like frogs. Did we have frogs in Egypt? Yes. The Lord is doing the same thing. The three spirits like frogs, and they came out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. So we know that these people are presenting frog-like messages, so to speak. Right, if you want to do it like that, okay? All right, so we move on, because we're going to do some summary. That's why we're moving on so quickly. So those are the three frogs coming in the interview. Three frogs, because one for each of the evil empires, the dragon, which is the devil, and all the entity that work with him, and the beast, who give homage to the dragon, and the false prophet. Okay, it's like a trinity. See, trying to mimic the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's what it's all about. Okay, so we move on. Okay, so there we have the dragon, the false prophet, and the beast. Seven heads and ten horns, and the one with the two horns like a lamb. Speak like a dragon. Remember, we studied that in Revelation 13. Okay. And those who missed some of what we studied before can go back on the website and look on the video archives at the scriptureoftruth.net, and they will see our previous presentation about the beast and the false prophet and the dragon. All right, so we move on. And it says that these frogs, it says they are spirits of demons, and they perform miraculous signs. Look at that, right? They perform signs, and they go out to the kings of the world to gather them for the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Remember what that battle is? It's called the great day of God Almighty. It's not a battle of the nations coming together. It's the great day of God Almighty. It's the battle of God. Okay, so we move on. We're gonna give you a summarization of all these scriptures that we're looking at. So we're moving through them quickly at this moment. We move on to the next. So it says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with him, so that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. Then they gathered the kings together in the Hebrew place, in a place that is in Hebrew is called Armageddon. So here we see that the Hebrew was still alive when John was writing. He's using some Hebrew terms. in the Hebrew, it's called Armageddon. All right, so we're going to look into that and see what that is all about. So we move on. Okay, so we're going to look into Armageddon now. Note this now. It says, even non-believers discuss Armageddon today. See, even non-believers. So, of course, we're going to have some all different kind of interpretation. From unbelievers? Really? From people who do not know the Bible? Really? From people who don't read the Bible, they're going to come with all kind of things. So we need to be careful of how we interpret it. All right? But most of all, I would say to most people, of all the interpretations that you have, okay, we'll wait and see what happens. Right? And see who is right. So we're going to give you what the Bible says here today. So it says, even non-believers discuss Armageddon today. The devil will work miracles to assemble the armies of the world under the banners of his false religion called the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. In Revelation 16, all the nations of the world will be engaged in this last great battle when Yeshua, Jesus, returns. It's the last battle. It's a spiritual battle. Okay, so we're going to do a quick question and answer and see if we have some answers here. So the first question is, what does the Bible say about Revelation being impossible to understand? Did the Bible say Revelation is impossible to understand? No, it did not. It says, God offers a blessing to those who read Revelation and do what it says. And the angel declares that the book is not sealed. We read that in Revelation 1 verse 3, 22, 7 to 10. It's an open book. By the very word itself, it says Revelation. Revelation means to reveal. Revelation, revealing, is the revelation of Jesus. So as we said again, if we don't see Jesus in the book of Revelation, if all we're studying is about beasts and mark of the beast and who is the mark of the beast and we forget that it's about Yeshua, we miss the point altogether. It's about Jesus. Everything. As we have been doing in the Revelation seminar, we see Jesus in it. Yeshua. Amen? All right, so we move on. Next question. It says, the language of the book of Revelation is largely borrowed from other parts of the Bible. That's what we have been saying all during the week. This is especially true of which book of the Bible? We compare another book.
Where was Egypt.
Yes, it's a symbolism. Yes, but which book of the Bible also Revelation took its imagery from? A special book we looked at last week. I think it's Daniel. Yes. So we get the answer. Another book that is borrowed from a part of the Bible is the book of Daniel. I remember we said Daniel 2:7 talks about beasts, images, and so forth. And so we got the same imagery. So we're laying a foundation here to say Revelation is symbolic. Don't take it too literal. Okay, so we move on. Next question. It says, the Bible gives its own approach to interpreting its prophecies. Right? What is this approach? Isaiah 28:10 gives us the answer. It says, here a little, there a little. The Bible recommends comparing all scripture passages on a given topic so that you get the big picture. Right? Compare every topic, see if you can find the topics, and then we get the big picture. So I'm laying the foundation for Armageddon. So we're going to look at it, see what it's all about. All right, so we move on. So here it is now. The word Armageddon in Revelation is derived from the Hebrew word, because it says the Hebrew word in Revelation, it tells you it's a Hebrew word. We just read it, Revelation 16, right? It's derived from the Hebrew words Har Megiddon. Har, we know, is mountain, and Megiddon. And which means, the answer, the mountain of Megiddo. That's what it means. The mountain of Megiddo. So many people see Armageddon and they say, oh, you know, it's going to be this place, whatever it is. But the word simply means mountain of Megiddo. And there are things that happens on this mountain or near the mountain, which the Lord is using as a spiritual entity, an understanding for what his people is going to be doing in the last days. So we get the picture. All right, so we're going to look at some things that happen near Megiddo. Okay, so next question. Okay, so look at this now. In 2 Kings 23, 29 and 30, right? It says, in his days, Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt, went up to the king of Assyria to the river Euphrates. You see that again? The river Euphrates is in there. King Josiah went to meet him, and Pharaoh Necho killed him where? Armageddon. See that? Right, he killed him at Megiddo. As soon as he saw him, he killed him at Megiddo as soon as he saw him. Verse 30 says, and his servants carried him dead in a chariot from Megiddo and brought him to Jerusalem and buried him in his own tomb. And the people of the land took Jehoaz, the son of Josiah, and anointed him and made him king in his father's place. So there was a war. Again, see, there's a war between God's people and the enemy. See? It's between God's people and the enemy. It's not between just regular nations that people are saying is going to go in the Middle East and fight. It's going to be, keep note of that, it's between God's people and the enemy. Egypt, symbol of the enemy. God's people, King Josiah. Right? Get the picture? All right, next one. In 2 Chronicles 35:20-27. Yeah. Is another same story, but it gives you another viewpoint, right? It says, after all this, when Josiah had prepared the temple, see, the temple, Necho, king of Egypt, went up to fight at Carchemish on the Euphrates, and Josiah went out to meet him. But he sent envoys to him, saying, what have we to do with each other, king of Judah? I am not coming against you this day, but against the house that with which I am at war, and God has commanded me to hurry. Cease opposing God. See that? Who is with me, lest he destroy you? Nevertheless, Josiah did not turn away from him, but disguised himself in order to fight with him. He did not listen to the words of Necho from the mouth of God, but came to fight in the plain of Megiddo. Right? And the archer shot King Josiah. And the king said to his servants, take me away, for I am badly, next, wounded. So we get more information about how the battle went down. Right? Josiah was disobedient. The Lord gave him warning and said, don't go. And he went. So again, we are seeing at the Megiddo, the conflict again between God and the people. So we get in the Revelation scenario. So we come into it. So his servants took him out of the chariot and carried him in his second chariot and brought him to Jerusalem, New Jerusalem, and he died and was buried in the tomb of his fathers. All Judah and Jerusalem mourned for Josiah. Jeremiah also uttered a lament for Josiah, and all the singing men and singing women have spoken of Josiah in their laments for his day. They made these a rule in Israel. Behold, they are written in the laments, that must be Lamentations, right? Now the rest of the acts of Josiah and his good deeds, according to what is written in the law of the Lord. And his acts, first and last, behold, they are written in the book of the kings of Israel and Judah. So you can find it, that's why we read Kings and Chronicles. You can find more information at Megiddo. So that's two mentions of Megiddo. So we're laying the foundation for Revelation, why it says Armageddon, Mountain of Megiddo, or Megiddon. All right, so we move on, laying the foundation. So here we get it now. So another question is now, which is the most prominent mountain at the Valley of Megiddo, and what happened there? Is at the Valley of Mount Megiddo, there's a great mountain, and something happened at that mountain. 1 Kings 18:19-21 tells us, right? Let's see. Mount Carmel. I know Clifford was thinking about it. Yeah. Mount Carmel was the site of Elijah's spiritual challenge to those involved in false religion. Remember, Baal worshippers. They were worshipping a false god, and Elijah came and said, if your god is God, let him bring fire up on the altar. And we know the story. You can read that in 1 Kings 18, right? So that was near the Megiddo, all right? So we're getting a foundation of things that are happening close by. Okay, so in Revelation 16:12 now, it refers to the drying up of the Euphrates River. And we saw the Euphrates in the story in 2 Kings when Josiah was killed at Megiddo. All right? Historically, this literally happened in conjunction with which event? There's an event in the Bible. Remember the story of Daniel 5, Belshazzar? Right? Belshazzar was the last king of Babylon, and Medo-Persian was coming to capture him. And but the river runs into Babylon. So the way to get into there, while they were having their Daniel 5, when the writing came on the wall, meaning take all you forcing, your the kingdom is found wanted and divided and is given into the hands of the Medes and the Persians. Daniel 5, right? And there we have Daniel 5. It says, the fall of Babylon, when Cyrus, the Persian general, dried up the Euphrates River so that his army could go under the wall to take the city. Okay, so historically, literal Babylon is used throughout the book of Revelation as a symbol of religious confusion and rebellion against God. So we said that before, whenever we see Babylon in Revelation, it's symbolic. Because there are some people who are saying that Babylon has to be rebuilt to fulfill Revelation. No, it's symbolic. Because the Bible already said that Babylon will not be rebuilt. Right? It will not be inhabited again. And if it is, the Bible is false, and the Bible is not going to be false. People are going to try to do it, but it's not going to last. So it's spiritual. The Bible says in Revelation 18, which we're going to study later on, 2 weeks from now, it says, come out of Babylon. Babylon is fallen. Come out of where my people. Because Babylon represents the false religion and confusion and rebellion against God. Okay. All right. So we get that. All right. So therefore then, the overthrow of ancient literal Babylon points to this is reasons for overthrowing spiritual Babylon. What was the reason? Why did it says God has a great desire to bring his people back to the promised land. Literally, just as he still has a great desire to bring us back to the kingdom of heaven. Our spiritual promised land. He's going to come, and we know we're going to go back to Jerusalem, but not the way it is now. It's going to be cleaned up and brand new when Yeshua comes in Jerusalem from heaven. Amen? And landed on where Jerusalem should be on this earth, when the earth is made new, not in the state that it is now. The Bible tells us that. Okay. So we move on. So we know the Bible talks about the three frogs and they do miracles. So the question was, is the miraculous always a sign that God is at work? Is a miraculous sign? No. Yeah, there are false. So we need to know them by their fruits, the Bible says. It says, even the demons are said to be working miracles in the last days. Revelation 13:13-14. Right? Okay, so it says they are spirits, that's what it says. Demons performing miraculous signs. And they go out to kings of the earth to gather them for the great battle of the great day of God Almighty. Notice it says, most people don't see that. Notice it says, it's the great day of God Almighty. That's the battle. It's God's battle. It's not a battle between the United States and the Middle East or the Middle East and Russia, as most people are saying. This one here is a spiritual battle between God's people and those who are disobedient. And the Lord is going to come to do justice and judgment at the final battle. We're going to read about that final battle of Revelation 20. All right, so we move on. We're coming to a close. It says now, at the conclusion of the battle, Jesus has a sword coming out of his mouth. He said, what does the sword represent? And we know it said, the Bible said, the sword represents the word of God. And it comes in Revelation 19. All right, so that is the conclusion of the battle in Revelation 19. He's coming on a white horse to give judgment and vengeance. He says, what does this say about what's important when Christ appears? So what's important? He says, what really matters in the end is what the Bible said and not what people say. All right? That's the key. It's what God says, not what people say. All the different interpretations is what the Bible says, spiritual understanding. We need to get back to the Tanakh so we can understand Revelation. And get back into the I was reading an article, I may share it with you next week since this came up, that says a fellow was doing a survey and he says they asked him a question. What surprised you about mega churches? He says, okay, when I went into mega churches, I don't see no Bible. All I see is technology video, this and that, and people say their own stuff, but there's no open Bible. Yes. Yes. Yes, even though we have the app, Bible on the phone, they can read that. We know technology is moving, but yes, it's true. But the most people, especially in the so-called Christian nations, they do not read the Bible anymore. Yes, that's correct. So what matters is what the Bible says and not what people say. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, so we move on. So it says the entire sinful world will be on one or the other of two sides in this final conflict, either on God's side or on the Satan's side. That's the battle. It's not, as we keep saying it, it is called the battle of the great day of God Almighty. In the midst of Armageddon, when Yeshua appears with the armies of heaven, surrounded by power and great glory, the world's wicked will panic and call for the rocks and the mountains, so we're getting the picture now, to fall on them and hide them from the face of Yeshua. Amen. The final battle. Amen. Hallelujah. And we know, we continue to be faithful here, and all those who are listening, we will be on the Lord's side. Amen. Hallelujah. So we move on. Coming to a close here. So, what decision will you make, all those who are watching us? You know, will you be on God's side or on the losing side? We hope that you say yes, you'll be on God's side. So the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and out of the temple came a loud voice from the throne saying, so the sealed throne in heaven, it is done. Yeshua said on the cross, it is done. That when he said that, doesn't mean everything was done. It means what his work came on earth was done. It continues in heaven. When he comes again, finally, this it is done means it is done. No more. Forever and ever. Bringing a new heaven and a new earth. Amen? Next. Then there came flashes of lightnings and rumblings, peals of thunder and severe earthquake. Earthquake like it has ever occurred since man has been on earth. So tremendous was the quake. So we have an earthquake, shaking of the earth, yes. Giving you some visual earthquake, and we have earthquake. Even though this is not talking about that, even though we have some earthquake recently in Italy and so forth, but when Yeshua comes, that's going to be a massive earthquake. Remember when he died, there was an earthquake. When he rose too, right? And as the graves opened, yes. True. Yes. Yes. Okay, so it said the great city split in three parts and the cities of the nations collapsed. God remembered Babylon, not the literal Babylon, but God remembered Babylon the Great and gave her the cup filled with the wine of fury of his wrath. Every island fell away and the mountains could not be found. From the sky, huge hailstones of about a weight of a talent fell upon men, and they cursed God on the account of the plague of hail, because the plague was so terrible. So the final bowl, the final plague, is going to be a plague of hailstones, about the weight of a talent, very heavy, 100 pounds. Final judgment. See, a stone coming down. Amen. So finally, we do a quick summary. We see here, right, the seven vials aim at punishing seven sins of unrepentant men. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. The seven trumpets in chapter 8 and 11 correspond with the vials in Revelation 15 and 16. When we look at it in Revelation 8, when we study it, it is similar to Revelation 15 and 16. So we have, if you look at it, we see springs of water in Revelation 8. Over there you see springs of water with the plagues. We have the sun, we have darkness, the river Euphrates, the same thing mentioned in Revelation 8, and the great voices. So that's a comparison for those who are watching, can pause and rewind. So we're coming to a close. Okay. And then we have the nature of the 10 plagues of Egypt. We mentioned that is similar to the plagues of the Revelation. Okay, so we move on. And the people of God were spared the last seven of Egypt's 10 plagues. The first three, they were impacted, and the last seven, they were not. That's why we're going to have seven in the last and the last days. Okay. Yes, we did that. So before each of the first six plagues, Pharaoh hardened his heart. Then God stopped calling him to repentance. And we read that, we read where the people were saying they curse God. Similar occurrence will happen again. Before God finally come and take his people home, similar to what he did when he take the people home from Egypt. Amen. So Pharaoh there represents the false religion and rebellious people. Amen. Okay, so we move on. And then we have some more stuff here that we're going to continue with next week. Right, so we're going to pause here and we continue next week looking at the similarities. And then we move into Revelation chapter 17. Okay, all right, so we thank those who are watching online. We see, and we hope you understand what we are trying to say. And we hope to have you back next week. We do Revelation chapter 17. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to do a quick summary of what we did today and move on into Revelation chapter 17. So we hope that you learned something today. We hope that you continue to study. And we say good day, good night, good afternoon, buenos dias, buenas tardes, buenas noches. Tahal Emet, the scripture of truth. www.thescriptureoftruth.net. So at this time, we're going to stand and bless the food that was prepared for us so we can eat. And we say, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Amotze Lechem Min Haaretz. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Amen. And we know that Yeshua is the bread of life. Right? He says, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Borei Pri Agafen. Blessed are you, Adonai our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And we know Yeshua is the vine, and we are the branches. Amen? We must just stick to him. Amen. And so we're going to do the Aaronic benediction. It says, Yivarekaka Adonai Vayishmereka, Yahir Adonai Panav Eleka, Vikuneka, Yisa Adonai Panav Eleka, Vayasem Leka, Shalom. May Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yahweh make his face to shine upon you. May Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and give you his shalom. Amen. Peace. We're going to eat some food, and all those who are watching, we say thank you. I hope to see you again next week. God bless you all. Amen. Hallelujah.